Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon. On the 64th anniversary of its establishment, the State of Israel is still called on to fend off claims denying and rejecting its existence. Major such claims are backed by a critique of Israel's behavior towards the Palestinians, by the view that the Jewish people in the area is not a collective entity that justifies the Zionist claim of national rights in the land of Israel. From time to time, Israel is boycotted allegedly because of its international morals, so to say. Israeli army commanders and security leaders have been threatened with arrest in foreign countries, allegedly based on international law. Criticism of particular policies has turned into complete negation based on high principles of justice and law, and expressions of anti-Semitism hide behind a facade of decency expressed in lofty terms. This delegitimization of Israel is connected to the singling out of Jews over other ethnic groups. There is no doubt about the right of existence of countries whose violations of human rights exceed those ascribed to Israel, and this is an understatement. Not only transgressions and inequitable deeds are used to negate Israel's legitimacy, but also horrible acts committed against Jews in Europe are used in a perverse dialectics to negate Israel's right to exist. Still 77 years after the end of the Second World War, the Holocaust is used as a rationale against Israel's existence because, in the opinion of some, its establishment was a result of the guilty conscience harbored by the West. Justice will be served when, according to them, history is rewritten. And in order to explain this argument pragmatically, other considerations are added, leading to a conclusion that the future of Israel is in doubt, not solely for moral, so to say, reasons, but also in realistic terms. Indeed, one cannot disassociate the negation of Israel's legitimacy from visible latent anti-Semitism. I shall not deal with the most recent example of latent anti-Semitism that has been strongly and loudly knocked on a tin drum. After all, it is quite natural for a former Waffen-SS member to blame the Jews, since die Juden sind unser Unglück. The Jews are our misfortune, and they should be severely punished. Right now, it is not politically correct to blame the Jews as such. So he did not repeat that slogan verbally. However, it is fashionable to blame Israel, and that is what he has done. Let me turn to another famous writer, Norwegian author Jostein Garda, who wrote Sophie's World, that most of us have read. Mr. Garda, during the Second Lebanon War, published a hostile article with a clear anti-Semitic message. Apparently, the opening sentences of the article compare between Israel and other sinful countries, but a closer look at the text reveals that only Israel loses legitimacy for its very existence due to its sins. Garda writes, "This is the time to learn the lesson. We no longer recognize the state of Israel. We refuse to acknowledge the apartheid government in South Africa and the Taliban government in Afghanistan. Many people are not familiar with the regime of Saddam Hussein in Iraq or the Serbian ethnic cleansing. Now it is time to get used to a new idea. Israel, in its present state, is part of history." Unquote. No other country but Israel, in his opinion, lost the right to exist because of its actions. Hence, it will not be able to continue to exist and can already be perceived as a historical perspective. This concept is also theological in part. The author fully denies and rejects the concept of chosen people and calls it madness and a crime against humanity. According to him, Israel alone is responsible for losing legitimacy by means of its action. He does not call for replacing the government of Israel on the basis of its policies, but to replace the nation as a whole. Do not fear, he calls in a stance of propaganda. The horror will pass soon, and Israel can already see its end. To demonstrate his point, he calls for a boycott of Jaffa oranges and ends the article with a call to Palestinians and Lebanese to give shelter, milk and honey to Jewish refugees when they leave and begin a new diaspora. A similar, almost similar claim, without the anti-Semitic overtones, was illustrated in the patronizing style of famous historian Tony Jott 3 years before Gadar. He writes that Israel is the last remnant of the national states established in Central and Eastern Europe at the end of World War I. However, Israel was established only in the second half of the 20th century, and therefore it has arrived to the scene too late. Moreover, Jewish nationalism and religion, he writes, are anachronistic, and Israeli leaders tend to fascism, no less. Against this background, Israel's condition is hopeless. The article was written in the midst of the Second Intifada, and the famous historian completely rejects the ability of Israel to continue to exist based on both legitimacy crisis and the future victory of the Palestinian suicide bombers. An allegation about Israeli apartheid policies without denial of Israel's right to exist was first raised by former President Jimmy Carter in his book, Palestine, Peace, Not Apartheid. Carter calls for partition, for an end to the annexation of land to Israel because it is against UN decisions and the Camp David Accords. According to President Carter, Israel is conducting apartheid policies, namely the separation of two populations living in the same country and subjugating the Palestinians to the level of second-class citizens. Carter calls for Israel to retreat to the Green Line in accordance with agreements included in the agreements on territorial exchanges that will consider the security needs of Israel and honor the autonomy of all nations in the Middle East. He shows sympathy to the Palestinian cause, but on the other hand, he demands from the Arab world to accept peace with Israel and guarantee its security, and of course to recognize it. From the Israeli public diplomacy perspective, this opinion has significant credence, as it proves that it is possible to criticize Israeli policy without negating Israel's existence or its right to exist. Despite the accusations of apartheid policies towards Palestinians and the manner in which they damage Israel's image and moral standing. In other words, Carter causes damage to Israel's image, but at the same time, he explains that even those who endorse the criticism of Israel should not necessarily go as far as to deny its right to exist as an independent state that does not rule over the Palestinians. However, it should be mentioned that Carter's rhetoric towards Israel focused on the morality of its policies, but his rhetoric toward the Palestinians is much more empathic. Against this background, the significance of a strongly based public diplomacy is important and should function in a sophisticated manner in order to ward off claims against Israel before they are internalized by the public and among opinion leaders and decision makers. However, Israel's leaders should first of all refrain from playing into the hands of the Palestinians. And what happened yesterday proves this demand of mine. Don't play into their hands. Don't do what they want you to do in order to gain. Secondly, Israeli leaders should not make the state's right to exist an item for negotiations, as if it is up to our enemies to determine whether or not we enjoy a right to exist. As the founding fathers of Israel described in the Proclamation of Independence, the establishment of a nation state for the Jewish people was, and it still is, our natural and historic right. The natural right stems from the inherent right to exist that comprises self-consciousness and expressed in the decisions of the First Zionist Congress regarding a safe sanctuary for the Jewish people in the land of Israel, in Palestine, they wrote indeed, recognized by the laws of nations. This is an autonomous decision of a representative group articulating a nation's legacy and its continuous existence and aspirations to return as free people to its ancient homeland. This inherent right does not require external sources for its legitimacy. It is self-evident, and its acceptance is axiomatic. The Zionist aspirations were given international recognitions in the Balfour Declaration of 1917, the decision by the Allied Supreme Council of Nations in San Remo, 1920, the decision of the League of Nations on presenting the mandate for Palestine to the British government, 1922, the recommendation of the Royal Commission headed by Lord Peel, 1937, on partition, and the UN Assembly decision 181 of November 29th, 1947. It lies also in the official recognition of the State of Israel by the majority of nations in the world, and Israel's entrance and acceptance as a member of the United Nations. Let me quote from the two most influential Israeli prime ministers on this matter. David Ben-Gurion, his evidence before the Peel Commission, 1937. "We are here registering our future in the country because it is our just and endowed natural right, whether or not it is beneficial for others. The Jewish people have the right to live in freedom towards this goal. Our right to the land of Israel does not stem from the British mandate and the Balfour Declaration. It precedes them. The Honorable Chairman of the Royal Commission, or one of his friends, commented on the meetings of the mandate, that it is the Bible of Zionism. On behalf of the Jewish people, I can say, the Bible is our mandate, not vice versa." Menachem Begin, from a speech in the Knesset at the presentation of his first government in 1977, 40 years later, he said as follows: "The government of Israel will not ask any nation, near or far, large or small, to recognize our right to exist. It does not occur to any British, French, Belgian, or Dutch, Russian, or American to ask on behalf of his people the right to be recognized to exist. To exist is an inherent right, and this is lawful for Israel. We do not expect that others ask on our behalf for our right to exist in the land of our forefathers. A different awareness is required between us and our neighbors, the recognition of our sovereignty, and the mutual need for peace and understanding," unquote. Last but not least, let me touch upon the argument that connects the establishment of Israel with the Holocaust. Former German Chancellor Helmut Schmidt was not the only one to make this false argument. Iranian President Ahmadinejad has remarked on several occasions, even on the UN podium, that Israel was established because of the guilt of the Jewish people embedded in the hearts of nations around the world against the background of the Holocaust, which he, of course, denied. The Palestinians and their supporters claim that there is no justification to casting on them and on their offspring the responsibility for the results of the Holocaust. These claims ignore the building of the land during some 50 years before achieving statehood, through the organizational and civil society achievements of the Zionist movement and the Yishuv. They ignore the international recognition of the Zionist aspirations, as I explained some moments ago. Indeed, the Holocaust and the statehood are two most significant historical events in all the history of the Jewish people since the destruction of the Second Temple in Jerusalem in the year 70. They occurred in close proximity, time-wise, which in itself is a subject of admiration for the moral power of the Jewish people who rose out of the ashes of the Holocaust and fought for national liberation. However, there is a difference between time connection and causality. The time proximity does not automatically make the former the cause of the latter. In order to understand the events in a historical perspective, it is crucial to look at the particular background that precede a given event. But this may be the subject of another lecture. Thank you.